Hello there. My guest this morning first met in the Farmgate Cafe in Cork's English Market about 15 years ago. One of them was writing a play. The other was struggling with a law degree while playing in a band and was asking to audition for his first ever professional acting role. They met to talk about the character of Pig in a play called Disco Pigs. It'll be true to say that at that moment, neither of these young men realised that a future of great artistic and creative achievement lay in store. For one is a writer, for the other is an actor. 15 years later, Enda Walsh is an award-winning playwright at the forefront of his generation of Irish writers. His plays, including Disco Pigs, Bedbound, The Woolworth Farce and The New Electric Ballroom, have been critically acclaimed. And Cillian Murphy's work as an actor on stage and screen has been acclaimed too, whether in the original stage performance of Disco Pigs or in films like Breakfast on Pluto, The Wind That Shakes the Barley, Inception or Batman Begins. Cillian is indeed a leading actor of his generation. They first worked together 15 years ago on the stage production of Disco Pigs, and this summer at the Galway Arts Festival they're back in the theatre working together on a one-man play written and directed by Enda and performed by Cillian. The play is called Mr. Man. You're both really welcome to the programme.
Hello. Thanks.
That was such a long intro, but you see good. You're both so successful. I have to give this big long intro. So what's it like working together again?
It's great. You know, we live in London, both, and we live about sort of 5 minutes walk from one another, and our kids, I've got a 6-year-old girl and he's got a 6-year-old boy and a 4-year-old little boy. And so we've been hanging out for a long time. So there's that sort of shorthand there. And also, I suppose I've known him for that long. And, you know, he's younger than me by, you know, whatever it
is. An hour.
By an hour. And but it feels very easy and all that sort of thing.
And how did you go about deciding to do this play again? Whose idea was it?
We worked together in Disco Pigs, as you mentioned. And that was, for me, that was my first ever professional gig as an actor. And it was a real life changer for me. I mean, my life changed completely after that show. A couple of years ago, I stopped and I thought, why haven't we worked together since? You know, it's kind of strange that we haven't, given that that was so successful and so brilliant. And at the time, I was keen to do some theatre again. So I said to Enda, well, listen, I want to meet you for a pint. And I'm not going to tell you anything. He's like, what? Tell me. What is it? Is it bad?
Because I talk like that.
And I said, listen, well, how about doing Mr. Man? And I think you're a bit taken by surprise. But you could be very, you know, really close friends with somebody, but working together is when it takes it to the next level, and you're really... Because Enda says you've all that shorthand there, all that trust, which you have to establish when you work with somebody for the first time. And we have 15 years of that, so it means that it's just straight to the work, and it's really exciting, you know.
Has it been interesting working with him again?
It's exciting because, of course, I've seen Cillian in productions over the years, and I've seen him in sort of movies and things like that, and you have some notion of what he is or what his work ends up as. But to sort of to see it then in the rehearsal room is a very sort of different thing, and to understand someone's processes is very interesting, you know.
You wrote this play yourself, yeah. What, about, when did you write it?
Yes, about sort of like 14 years ago, 13 years ago.
What is it about?
Whenever anyone says, what is it about? I always go, well, it's about an hour and 20 minutes.
but
this production, I think, is sort of watching a character reveal himself in terms of like his sort of psychosis, that over sort of an hour and 20 minutes you're looking at a very sort of peculiar sort of individual, and we're getting closer to him. Initially he's some little monster to us who's talking through sort of, you know, reel to reels and talking to different voices in these sort of reel to reels and existing in this huge warehouse. And yet over the sort of like hour and sort of 20 minutes or half an hour and a half, whatever it's going to turn out to be, we learn why he's sort of existing the way he's existing and what he's trying to sort of cover up in his past. I think it's a very sort of traditional, sort of rural Irish piece of theatre, but seen through the sort of fog of absinthe. and sort of like, it's sort of quite sort of hallucinogenic in its form and in its structure and in its presentation. It will be also, it will feel very like fragmented, but very familiar, I think, to an Irish audience at the same time.
It's dark as well, though, Cillian, and it's a one-man show.
Yeah.
So how are you finding even the rehearsals? Is it very demanding as a role?
Yeah, it is, but all of Enda's shows are demanding for actors. You know, he writes amazing dialogue. Yeah. It's always very dense, and it takes a while to unlock it. You kind of have to work with it, but it's so beautiful to say, you know? And also with all of Enda's work, there's definitely a darkness or a dark quality to it, but very, very funny. Well, hopefully. This other productions have been wonderfully funny. But hopefully this one will be funny as well. Actors talk about the one man, one woman shows, you know, that they are the sort of Everest, you know, of performance. But when you scale them, they can be so rewarding and so satisfying for the performer and for the audience. And I hope that's what we can achieve. You know, and I hadn't done theatre in a while. It had been about 5-6 years since I'd done a play, and so when you go back, you wanna work with the best people, and then you wanna work on something that's challenging to you, that takes you, offers new challenges, and this certainly is one. You know,
you write a lot about people on the extremes, almost in a sense, on almost the edge of madness sometimes.
I do sort of honestly feel a little bit at times toward, you know, like an affinity towards that. But also, you know, you want to sort of understand the people who are on the sort of periphery, supposedly, of society, these sort of disparate individuals who've been sort of cast aside. So I've always been interested in characters who are isolated, that so that the audience have a relationship when they walk in. They go, I really don't like this person. But yet we sort of strip away and spend a little bit of time on them. And they go, actually, they're so close to me. We're all made up of the same sort of thing.
And I'm also very intrigued by what an Enda's plays investigated a lot is, you know, what pressure does to the human condition, to the human psyche. If you put a normal person in extraordinary circumstances or in this case, you know, I think what's very interesting is we're examining a lot the guilt and how corrosive that can be on someone's state of mind. And we've all lived with a fact, and that is, you know, immutable, and you can't just change it. But eventually you have to process it. And that's kind of what this play is about to me.
Yeah.
Does he give out to you, like when you're rehearsing now in London, because you've flown in for this interview, when you're rehearsing, like, is Enda quite demanding or is he nice?
What a horrible thing.
He's nice and demanding.
Like any good marriage.
It's amazing for me watching him change from the playwright to the director, you know, because we did, you know, a lot of talking about the show, just sitting down in Enda's house drinking tea and just talking about the show, and then you actually are in a rehearsal room working on the piece, and then you see him put on the director's hat, and he's brilliant at it. I mean, I think because, I mean, he'll probably talk himself down as an actor, but he's really, really funny and very, you know, really good at character, and that's very helpful for an actor.
But can you remember the first time you met him?
Yeah, very, very well. I can remember it really clearly. I can remember what I was wearing. No, I can't. Wouldn't it be great if I did 15 years ago. but no, I mean, yeah, I can't. I mean, I got the sort of heads up from Pat Kiernan, who directed Disco Pigs, and we'd written this
play. He's Corkadurka,
yeah. You know, we'd done this terrible production of Animal Farm, and it was a complete disaster for me and Pat. We were almost sort of closing up the company, and I said, well, listen, let's have one last go. And I wrote this two-hander, Disco Pigs, and you know, about the sort of failed relationship between me and my girlfriend at the time, and it came out in this weird sort of form and weird language, and I wrote it, and then Pat says, listen, you should check out this sort of actress. And I know that at the time I'd seen Eileen Walsh, who played the female character Runt in it. I'd seen her in Dante Dan in this Gina Moxley play. And she was like 17 or something. And I went, my God, look at her energy. So I was writing this play, and I thought, well, we'll go after that girl. But we had no idea about the boy. And then Pat went, listen, I saw this fella in Prez in school, you know, like, and he said, you should check him out. And then I met him, and I knew that he was in a band, and I sort of met him. And then I think we went to the Kirkadurka's offices. We had an office, but the company was folding. It was one of these sort of things. And then you read a really, really difficult speech. And I thought, oh my God, it actually sounds good. You know, like, because I didn't know what the play was and I didn't know how it would sound. I could hear it in my head. And I thought, oh wow. And then I was like, well, he can obviously sort of innately sort of has real talent. So we were so fortunate just in the energies of particularly sort of like, you know, the relationship that the two guys sort of had together.
Yeah. Eileen and Cillian, like, yeah. God, they were like, but you had heard of this role, had you?
Pat Kiernan, who directed the play.
Who's a legend in his own lifetime in Cork, isn't he, to be honest? Yeah.
He is, you know, Kirkadurka and doing amazing work. He's an past pupil of Prez in Cork, where I went, and it went in fourth year in school, which was the first year of like transition year. So we were given drama modules, and he came in and did this this drama module in school with us, and I thought he was the coolest person ever. Like, and so we were just trying to impress him with our little sketches and stuff. And
clearly did.
And I'd gone to see other Crooked Orchid productions that the lads had put on, like, and like they did this amazing production of Clockwork Orange and Sir Henry's and stuff like that. And I would bug Pat and say, "Look, what are you doing next?" And then he said, "Look, I've got this show," and that's kind of how it came about. And then Enda auditioned me.
And do you remember the first time you met him?
Yeah.
Did you like him?
I did. Yeah. He was just like as he is now, just so easy and so nice. This is a professional theatre company. I was this young, you know, nobody off the street, but like being treated really sound and really nicely and really with a lot of respect. And you think about that as a you know, and then to cast the part is a very brave thing to do. Some fellow who had no experience whatsoever, and such a gift of a role.
And you're also really lucky because you got that break so young. Like you'd never been that much of a struggling young actor, have you?
That was an amazing gift to be given that role, you know, and to then we brought it to Edinburgh, we brought it to London, we brought it to all these festivals around the world, and you know, it's a two-hander of a show, and to work with these amazing, you know, artists. Yeah, it was a real gift. And I guess gave me a great platform. Then I got an agent. And I mean, you still have to work and you still have to learn. But yeah, I realise in retrospect that I was really, really lucky to get that part, you know, at the time.
And the language in that play, of course, is amazing.
You know, I mean, I'm
like baby language.
Yeah, but I'm a sort of Dublin man sort of who moved down to Cork. So when I got off the whatever, got out of the car, you know, when I arrived in sort of Cork, someone drove us down there. I was going, are you serious? Do people really talk like this? I was shocked, you know, like, and then I immediately fell in love with the place, like really, really quickly. You know, as you do as a sort of like, you know, a youngish man, you know, like whatever it was, 23, arriving there and going, what a great city, the size of it looked. It sort of dramatically, it was just all so right for me, the sound of the place, the sort of the character of the people and, you know, all of that.
You were both young then, very young, doing these plays. Was it a crazy time in Cork? Was it a good time?
There was a lot of things happening. There was a great music scene. There was a great sort of dance music scene. There was like pirate radio stations, there was, and Kirkadurk, obviously, there seemed to be a real energy. Yeah, this is mid-90s in Cork.
There was a few summers, weren't there? Yeah. About 3 years in a row that I thought were really amazing.
The interesting thing, though, is you were both in bands.
Well, yeah.
You were both singers. Don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to sing, but you were both in bands.
Yeah, well, I didn't know you were in a band.
In fairness,
really?
Give me the name of it again. It's a really complicated title.
It was, get ready for this. This is why it was called the Readily Salted Peeled Baby Kaylee Band. And I was in a band in anyone sort of like at the time, and like, you know, Rathmines Communications, sort of doing communication. It was like, I think we lasted about 3 gigs. And we were post punk. We did sort of Lionel Richie sort of songs really fast. It was like that embarrassing. It was dreadful. I mean, you were in a proper band.
Well, compared to that, yeah.
Tell us about your band. What were they called again?
We were called the Sons of Mr. Green Jeans. It was my brother and a few really close friends. And we were taking it very seriously, I guess, at the time I met Pat and Enda. You know, that's what I wanted to do. But I guess, I never felt like I could be really, really good at it, at the music. Mm. I always felt I could be okay at it. And it was only when, like, I got the part in Disco Pigs, I thought maybe I can be actually good at something.
Yeah. Well, your parents didn't want you young. They put a stop to the group at first? Was it because your brother was still in school?
Yeah, he was only like 16 or 17, and it was getting a bit serious. And my parents were like, well, look, two with one fell swoop would be just too much. So,
to lose one child.
Because you dropped out of law course, didn't you?
I did, yeah. Yeah, that was Enda's fault as well.
Yeah. Listen, we'll come back to that. Since we're discussing music, we're going to take the first piece, which is one you like, the Ronettes, about Disco Pigs.
Yes, I picked this tune because I must have mimed to it about 400 times over the 18 months we did Disco Pigs. It's a brilliant, brilliant tune. Be My Baby, the Ronettes.
Be my baby now.
the Ronettes there with Be My Baby. Great song.
Yeah, it's too good, isn't it? It's
what so were you great. Saying about Brian Wilson?
Yeah, the Brian Wilson, he used to, of the sort of the Beach Boys, he used to listen to that every day. He had to listen to that every day. It was, for him, it was just the most perfect thing.
But look, we were speaking a little earlier, Cillian. I mean, you went to Pres in Cork, mm-hmm. and your parents, your mum's a teacher, is she?
Mum is a teacher, yeah. Just retiring this year, actually. And my dad is retired Kigger Scullo. And come from a long line of teachers, actually. My grandfather was a headmaster, and a lot of my aunts and uncles are teachers. So
what do they think about you heading into the acting world? At the time, forget now, obviously.
At the time, I think they probably would have preferred if I'd finished the degree and then decided then. But they're delighted, though. Like, but I chose the wrong course, definitely. But listen, if I hadn't gone in there, I wouldn't have been doing this, so...
And as a playwright, and I mean, it didn't start that easy for you. Tell me about your background. Where did you grow up? What your parents do?
I grew up in Rohini. My dad had a furniture business, and my mom was a mom. But years ago, before, I come from sort of a family of six, and I'm the second last. So my mom used to act. So there was an acting sort of gene definitely in there. I never saw her act, but growing up, I could tell that, you know, that, you know, there was a woman who sort of belonged on stage, you know.
And your dad, were like bedbound. I love your play Bedbound. Yeah. It's very sad, actually. Yeah. I think, but there's a lot of your father almost in there, do you think?
Yeah, all of it. I mean, I wanted to write a play about me and my dad, you know, about that sort of relationship of when you're in your 20s and then, yeah, or you dislike your sort of your parent or your father. That sort of simple premise, but then you sort of you really bond with them, and then you sort of love them in a new way, really sort of profound, big way. You know, it's sort of growing up sort of thing. That was at the centre of it, but I wrote this really quite sort of twisted sort of thing where it was the sort of the rise of this crazy sort of furniture salesman and his daughter who he's locked in a bed, who was the daughter being me, this gibbering wreck of a poor child. And he's locked her up. He's built this wall around her bed and kept her there sort of in cage, sort of Fritzl style in this sort of bed. So yeah, this very peculiar love story about me and my dad wrapped up in all this dysfunction. But in many ways, whenever I think of my dad, you know, and my dad has had a huge influence on my work, you know, theatrically he was an amazing, amazing actor, you know, like he had a shop in Donaghmede design store, so people will know him, sort of like his name is Sean Walsh, people go, oh, I remember Sean Walsh, and like he could work a room like no one else. He could work a sort of a whole floor. It was a big shop, and you know, we'd go into different sort of voices, you know, depending on who it was, you know, someone from the sort of, you know, Donaghmede background, or, you know, or someone from Hoth, you know, he'd be like, yeah, but that's great. And, you know, like, he could change personality really, really quickly.
He was a good actor, Cillian.
And also his body was like, he was a great mover. He was like a ballroom dancer. So, like, you know, he had all this sort of great show. So he was my first introduction to sort of theatre, and had an effect on that, but also watching a parent go through various recessions who's in a sort of business, watching the sort of the ups and downs of sort of business life. And that's why business people make fantastic sort of theatrical creations, is that it's all life there. You see the sort of ups and downs and the sort of like terrible, you know, people having shag all money or whatever it is. Or, you know.
But like that would resonate today, genuinely, so much for so many people, because your dad, did he lose his business in the 80s?
Well, it was sort of, yeah, he did. But it was because of the recession, but also because of his health. And I think, you know, the business, that sort of up and down sort of thing of like, you know, trying to keep a family, six kids going. And, you know, like, who wants to buy furniture during a recession? You know, you don't. So the business sort of goes. But the business was fine. But like, he had a brain hemorrhage in 1980. And, you know, was out of work for a couple of years, and I think the business was going to go. So, but, you know, for much of my life, I suppose he was sick, but, you know, in the sort of shadows, or in the sort of like, you know, or maybe in the, you know, I can still see the shape of his swagger, you know, and all that sort of thing, very much.
But there's a nice story I read about you doing a paper round. Tell me that.
Well, no, I had a very successful paper round in Rohini.
And, how old were you?
Many of the little old ladies. I tell you what, I really sort of abused a lot of the younger kids, because I used to sort of, you know, whatever, I'd throw them about sort of, you know, whatever it was, a fiver a week, you know, but I'd be sort of like, I was a bit of a mogul, a bit of a paper mogul. And like
entrepreneur.
An entrepreneur. And, so on a Friday, I would sort of count my takings sort of that day and what it was, and, you know, my dad be at the other end of the table counting his takings for the week, and I can remember that sort of thing of going, oh my god, look, I think I possibly have more money. You know, like, it's literally going, whoa, you know, that's sort of like, you know, that, but, you know, yeah. You know, like, you know, I feel very sort of, you know, sort of privileged to be sort of brought up like in an environment sort of like that. From a professional point of view, like, I think it's what's made me a playwright, you know, being in a, from a big family, and but also being from a family, you know, where we had such great, funny times, and really quiet sort of itchy sort of aches due to the recession, you know, and stuff like that.
Did he see Bed Band, or did he know about it?
He didn't. My poor dad, I mean, he died when I was rehearsing it. I directed it, and he died in the second week of rehearsal, but he knew about it. I said, listen, Dad, I've written this like monster of a play, and it's about you and me, but you must understand I completely, it's about, you know, the fact that I completely sort of love you. But it's really, really hard because the character in it is a monster. And, but I'm also a monster and in female form, by God. You know, like, and but my dad always liked that I wrote really hard stuff. He went, why not? You know, get it out there. I mean, the form of theatre sort of exists, but it exists there to be played with and to be thrown about. And you have to be sort of brave, and you also have to sort of smash up your head and sort of reinvent it, you know, and keep on going at it. And he always really responded to that and liked that.
Yeah, so. In terms of roles, it's too simplistic a question to talk about the difference between, you know, you, Cillian, acting in theatre and all the huge roles you've played. Is it different, though? Do you find it different now rehearsing for Mr. Man than, say, you know, Batman Begins? I mean, how does it differ for you?
Well, you don't really get rehearsals in films traditionally. I mean, some directors will a little bit, but I guess film is more about capturing the moment, you know, and about the spontaneity that exists and capturing that on film. I love the process of, like, what we're in the middle of now. We're heading into our second week of just in this kind of laboratory of, like, making this piece, and just me and Enda in this room, like, bashing the thing into shape, and it's very, very exciting. And you don't get that in film. It's very much like, got it, let's move on. And then you leave it in the hands of your director and your editor, and 16 months, 18 months later, you see this thing, and it's a completely different.
Are you self-critical of all those big roles you've played? Is there one you think you were best in? Like, would you regard yourself as having the best performance in which particular film?
You know, there's experiences that were amazing, and there's films that you're very proud of, but I really feel like that as an actor anyway, you have to be forward looking, you know, and if you get nostalgic, although I suppose we're indulging a little bit here, but if you get about performances anyway, it can stagnate a little bit. So you, like, it has to be all I can see in front of me is Mr. Man, you know, and you don't want to look back really.
You went to Greendale, of course,
yeah,
because I interviewed Roddy Doyle recently, and there's Seamus Hosey from this parish, actually. He was a history teacher. Yeah. What was that like, that school? Was it
great? Oh, it was a fantastic school. You know, I was from Rohingya, middle-class sort of boy, effectively, and going to sort of a school where, like, in the 80s, where there was 40% sort of unemployment in Kilbarrick, you know, a supposedly really rough area, but I found it great. Really great. My teachers, of course, were all about 24, 25. Yeah. Roddy and Paul, when you think of it, and Paul Mercier and Catherine Dunn, who sort of went on to be a novelist. And I mean, I was dead lucky because I wasn't bright, but I was always good with words.
You're not
and good
at
English.
English.
I was sort of good enough at English. I was never sort of like academic or anything like that. I could never sort of do that. I was always just a bit sort of flighty or something, you know, like my brain was always a bit sort of scatty for that, but I was very fortunate.
Didn't you win best story of the week?
Yeah, well, this was a thing Roddy used to sort of set, and it was a great thing. I think every Friday he used to read the best story, but it was a big thing amongst a few of us. We were going, Rob, what are you writing? We'd be in the yard, you know, having a quick smoke. I go, what are you writing here? You're writing, oh, that sounds good, yeah, that sounds good, yeah, really interesting, yeah. And at the same time, you know, like, Roddy had a sort of a cabinet at the back where, you know, you could read sort of Charles Bukowski and sort of like various sort of beat poets, you know. You'd do the curriculum in a couple of weeks, and then there'd be this stuff, and you go, oh my God, there's other languages out there and worlds up there. It was great. It was a really, really great school.
Because sometimes, Cillian, I know in certainly a lot of boys' schools, I have little boys, like, there's a big emphasis on sport.
Yeah. I mean, I actually had a great English teacher as well in school, Bill Wall, who, you know, he's a poet and a novelist. He very much encouraged me. The school is like a great rugby tradition in the school, but we used to play school concerts and, you know, I think it'll out wherever you are. I think Enda would have been a writer wherever he was. He ended up being in a great school and a great environment, but I think it's just there, it would have come out.
I think, with me,
you know, it was bound to come out. It was obvious I wasn't a rugby player from the beginning. You know.
He got success early, but you were saying, well, like when you went to communications in Rathmines, you dropped out of that, did you?
Yeah, was not for me. I mean, I said to someone, you know, learning about film in the sort of like early 1990s was, you know, like, you know, training for dentistry in a country where people don't have any teeth. It was just completely ludicrous sort of notion. It was like, well, there was no film industry, for God's sake. So I left.
How did you eventually break into writing? And where did you come home then to Ireland?
I think the writing was always sort of there for me. But I worked for a while in France with a film editor. But even when I was there, I was going, you know what? I really, really want to. I want to write. But I didn't know what or da-da-da. And I didn't know what else. But when I came back to Ireland from France, I came back to Dublin in the sort of early 1990s. The theatre scene was very, very small. And I tried to sort of, you know, get involved in theatre in Dublin for about a year and nothing worked. And I was living on the, you know, on the dole. And my dad was going, you know, just try and write then. You know, he was always very, very good. And then I got this job, this sort of acting role down in Cork. And I ended up down in Cork and then Pat Kiernan, and then it sort of took off
from there, and then there's Disco Pigs. Mm. We're going to take the next piece of music, which is Facing West. You like it,
Yeah. I like a lot of music, but like I'm going through, like many people, going through a folk thing. And this is an English folk group called The Staves, and they're three sisters, and they've had an EP out of which this one of these songs is on it. I just think they're very beautiful voices, nice harmonies.
And Facing West, is that because you live in London and you're homesick for home?
That's exactly it.
Okay, let's listen now to The Staves and Facing West.
Sing me a song, your voice is like silver, and I don't think that I can do this anymore.
The Staves there, your choice. I mean, it's really beautiful, actually.
Beautiful,
I've never heard
it
before. Listen, we're going to take another piece of music before we go on, Andy. Mm-hmm. Something from Jinx Lennon?
Yes.
Why do you like
it? It's the city of styrofoam cups, isn't it? Well, I just think Jinx Lennon is, I mean, he'd hate me for saying it, but I think he's just an absolute genius. I love this song particularly.
I pissed around for years with a dead loss. I ended up in a place called Foss, learning about forklifts and inventory. On the last day, the instructors told us to take us out for a feed of drink. You're on the brink of success, they said now, lads, in a patronising voice. I knew it was going to be back in the hole, yeah, back in the dole, yeah. I turned the keys in the ignition. It was a beautiful blue and yellow winter's evening. Went up to the city of styrofoam cups, yeah. The city of styrofoam cups, from far away, the city that's a great big chandelier. But when you get near, the light begins to separate and you see a different landscape, yeah, a different landscape.
Then in the city of styrofoam cups. That's great as well.
It's amazing. It's a great song, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's wonderful. One day someone's going to write a musical film based upon sort of like Jinx Lennon's sort of music. He's sort of cinematic in the way that he sort of talks about Dundalk, and it's so rich and amazing. The characters are extraordinary. And
you'll have to write this.
Yeah, I will have to write.
You both live in London, around the corner from each other. Do you like living in London?
Yeah, I really love it, and I love the distance and the proximity kind of to Ireland, you know. And don't miss home, because we're home so often. We go home to Cork and down west in Kerry a lot. But I just love London. I love the theatre and the film and the galleries and the parks and everything.
Do you still call here home?
Ireland?
Hmm.
No, I think your home is where you live with your family, and I guess that would be in London, yeah.
Do you like London?
I do, yeah. I love it. My wife's from London, and I've got a 6-year-old kid, and I think I've been there sort of 8 years. You know, of course, I'm an Irish writer, and always will be an Irish writer, and I always feel that sort of connection to Ireland. But strangely, it's always that sort of thing of living in a different city. It gives you a sort of a distance, and you can see yourself in relief, and you feel isolated, very small. It's only you and you're like a page or whatever it is, and you're trying to pour your ideas down in a huge city like that. You feel really invisible, and that's a very, very good thing for a writer to be, you know.
Where do you live?
To feel. I live in Kilburn.
Yeah, I'm around the corner from here.
But Kilburn's quite, I used to live in London, it's quite cool now in a sense. Are there still remnants though of, you know, almost sad Kilburn, when you'd see a lot of people who just never went home but wanted to go back home to Ireland?
Yeah. There are, you know, there's a couple of pubs over there that I have frequented, and you get those sort of those people who are lost, who just never made it home, who are just still there, you know, and they develop this sort of this dialect that's so strong that even as an Irish person you can't understand a word they're saying because they're just talking to sort of their world is now three friends around a table and they create this sort of this language themselves. So that's always incredibly sort of sad and very funny at the same time. And that generation of Irish person in Kilburn is dying out. But it's strange that, you know, I think there's a few Irish people that we know that have moved back into Kilburn to sort of to
repopulate it with a little bit of green.
Take it back over. Because you also have spoken about, you know, not obsessive compulsive behaviour, that sometimes...
For a while, I mean, Disco Pigs was in the West End at the time and I had developed some OCD, some sort of...
Routine,
massive sort of routine that, you know, I would have to sort of, you know, go out at a certain time. I would have to sort of have my bacon and eggs in a certain cafe, you know.
I don't remember this at all.
That's because you were having such a bloody good time.
You were in Hollywood.
And, I was there.
I had problems sort of traveling and I kept it. You would keep it sort of well sort of hidden. But it went on. It went on actually for sort of 2 years. That was the beginning of it. And it went on for sort of quite a long time. The day sort of became very sort of mathematical. The day was sort of, you know, ordered in minutes and sort of hours and all that type of thing. And you do certain things at a certain time. And weirdly, you begin to sort of see the world in terms of sort of maths, bizarrely. So you're walking down the sort of street and you know the sort of movement of the neighbourhood through minutes and hours. And, you know, and there's that people and they're there. Then any moment now they're going to pass. And there they are. They've just passed me. Of course they have, because it's 8:45 and I must be in such a place. So your world becomes bizarre and, you know, like a... And I felt as if, oh my God, I'm actually going quite mad here. And like any sort of like, you know, person who's going through anything as big as that, it became quite addictive. I think I sort of fueled it a little bit and probably kept it going for a year longer than what I should have done.
Were you unhappy at the time?
No, I was sort of blissfully sort of happy, actually. I was sort of like, I was with this beautiful woman that I, you know, like that I'd fallen in love with and it was all great. But I don't know, I probably, before that, partied probably too much and sort of like...
Did you drink?
There was probably other stuff involved, but
drugs.
It was just like... But it was a very mad time, you know, like a sort of very crazy sort of time for me. But I enjoyed the little, you know, flirtation with the obsessive compulsive disorder.
Is it sometimes that there's often a thin line, isn't there, sometimes between maybe being very bright, very creative and... being totally bonkers.
You have to be free. I think to make stuff, you have to be really free. You have to allow yourself to be free. And if something feels like just too ludicrous to do or too hard to do, you feel as if, you know, well, just do it. It's work, you know. All it is work. You know, we're just working things and sort of like freeing up your imagination and throwing something in front of an audience. And I've always sort of like really felt as if that should be the sort of sense of what we're doing as sort of theatre makers, and long may it continue. I mean, at least, you know, until people just stop producing me and go, do you know what? I think we've had enough of that imagination stuff.
Cillian is looking at you in belief, disbelief. Like, do you empathise or understand what he's talking about?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, I think being a writer is a different thing because, you know, it comes directly from his head. You know, and that's a different thing to what I do. And there are times, you know, you do read it or you're acting and you go, hang on a minute, where did this come from? And occasionally you get glimpses in there, but I think, like you were saying, it's stuff that you can work out, and that must be a great release. I guess for actors, it's the actual performing of it is the sort of a release. On stage, it's all a form of expression, however it comes out, I guess.
But how do you prepare for a role like legendary? If you talk to, say, Daniel Day-Lewis, he'll talk about submerging himself in a role. Like, I see you've grown a beard, obviously. No, for Mr. Man, quite a big beard, actually.
Yeah.
But that's obviously for this role.
Yeah.
But do you do other things to get into the
No,
role?
Just growing facial hair. Just sometimes a moustache, sometimes a goatee, sideburns. That's it.
But do you? Like, for Mr. Man, this role?
You know, this play is quite peculiar because of the subject matter and because that it's a one-man show and it's the character playing lots of other characters also. So it's basically like establishing this character and then... Like, Enda often talks about, you know, just lifting the lid in his head and having a good old look into his mind. So it's kind of coming from the inside out with this fella. A lot of the other times, like if you're playing an astronaut or playing a I don't know, whatever, you spent time reading about it, or you try and meet an astronaut and hang out with them. But in this case, you've kind of got to create it.
Thomas McGill.
You got to make Thomas McGill, yeah. And so it's peculiar and bizarre and kind of all-consuming, but...
But I must say that's the same experience that I have, you know, like as sort of writing a part, or even now, even just, you know, because the part doesn't exist, you know, like it's sort of it exists in a form, and I've always thought, you know, it's only a bunch of words and ideas and all that type of thing. As soon as, you know, an actor starts working on, they bring their own sort of soul to it. And probably one of the big sort of like interpretations of the big sort of moments of working on a part is actually deciding to do it.
Yes.
Because, you know, as soon as you sort of choose that sort of part, there's something within your sort of own heart or soul that's telling you, actually, I feel some affinity to that person. And that is a big step to take. And then the rest of it is actually sort of the investigation of that and the sort of the physical manifestation of it and the sort of, you know, the sound of them and all that type of thing.
But playing roles that you've written, like, they're not easy because they are quite dark.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, do you find if you end up playing Thomas McGill, which you're going to now in Mr. Man for a few weeks, does it blow your head by the end of it? I mean, do you get...
Yes, but in a brilliant, brilliant way, you know? It really is. I mean, that's what's so wonderful about theatre. And like what we mentioned about Enda, he sets out the biggest challenge he can for his actors, you know? And if you succeed... The rewards are so massive as well, and you come off the like hopefully come off the stage and it, you know, you feel like you've really been through something, and it's incredibly satisfying, and you've explored parts of your mind that you wouldn't generally get to do, you know.
But are they parts of your mind you want to explore?
Not all the time, but you get to do that through the work, you know.
That's why they're almost quite frightening.
I do write parts to break actors a lot of the time. But it's about, I want to see as an audience, I want to see just how incredibly brave it is, you know, to do that, to sort of be on stage, to be one man on sort of stage and going, God almighty, this person's working. And I really respond to that as an audience. I always think that theatre is just about to blow away. It's sort of like, it's a pretend set, it's pretend lights, everything is pretend. It only exists by the audience's sort of need for the imagination. And here we are, sort of like a group of people in the black box in Galway, looking at one actor on stage, pretending to be all these characters and playing this character. And it's our sort of will to sort of lose ourselves in the imagination of that character and that actor that sort of makes the whole thing sort of like bloody golden. And I think that's why, you know, as an art form, you know, like it's still, you know, it's so risky. It's so dangerous. It's so potentially, you know, foolish. But then it's sort of, it's lit up and then it's really spectacular, you know.
Have you ever directed film?
No, never. And I have no interest in it either, to be honest.
Cillian smiles. Why did you smile at that?
He's just, you know, he's the reason why theatre is so important, you know. I mean, having said that, he's written amazing films, you know.
Mm.
Written Hunger, you know.
Hunger, which is great.
Staggering movie. But I think, you know, his belief and passion for theatre is vital, you know. And the types of shows that he makes are so exciting and so dangerous. It's important he stays making those shows. Mm. Not that he couldn't direct film, but I think it's important for theatre he does keep on writing those shows.
Do you find it easy to write?
I have to say I do, actually, yeah. I mean, so, but I really, really enjoy it. I mean, if I didn't have it, I'd fall on the ground. And that's why any play that I've written always seems to be about characters who are barely existing, who, if they don't carry on, they'll actually fall on the ground and die. But I feel that way about sort of theatre and writing.
Well, look, we've come to the end. We're going to have a piece of music, which is, I think, yours, Cillian, Sufjan Stevens, Too Much.
I went to see him play in London there a couple of weeks ago, and it was just unbelievably inspiring theatrically. I mean, his music is amazing, but the show that he put on had a profound effect on me because we were in rehearsal at the time. So, and this is just an amazing song as well.
What do you mean it had a profound effect on you?
When you're making a piece of work and then you go and see somebody put on a show that is so brave and so confident and so, like, this was so theatrical, it just inspires you and makes you be brave in what you're doing yourself.
Because will you be nervous going out as a one-man show when this starts?
Yeah.
Seriously, will you?
Yeah, I will, but I'll... you'll try and harness it, like, try and ride it, you know, surf it.
And will you have a routine before you go on stage that first night?
I don't know, really. I really don't. It's been a while since I've done it. I don't know.
I'd probably just give you a rub down. I think that's what I usually do to my actors. I haven't told you that until now.
That's great.
Glad I grew the beard.
You do well then. But look, I'm looking forward to seeing it. And Mr. Man, the play you're both involved in rehearsing at the moment, a preview's from the 7th of July at the Black Box Theatre in Galway. It's written by you, Enda, obviously starring you, Cillian, and it's produced by Landmark Productions and the Galway Arts Festival. I hope, and I'm sure it's going to be a big success because you both put so much effort into it. Mm-hmm. My thanks and sound today to Mark Dwyer, to my producer Eileen Heron and Yeti Redmond. We're going to listen now to Sophie and Stephen's Too Much. Thank you very much for listening, and I'll be here at the same time next Sunday. If I was a different man, if I had blood.